Park Aviation Private Limited team. It's an honor to welcome our chief guest, Shikha Verma, to deliver an anonymous topic, Invest Your Happiness. We welcome you, ma'am, and the session is over to you.
Thank you so much, Rajeshree. And thank you to Aircruise for giving me this wonderful opportunity and platform to talk to our youngsters, especially kids who are all set to serve the nation. So thank you so much. It's wonderful to see Shikha, Surabhi, another Shikha, and Mansi. Is this the name that's attracting all the Shikhas on the call right now? I'm guessing there are more students who are about to join us. Do we want to wait for them or should we start, Captain?
No, you can carry on. This
okay,
is their that they are not joining on time. So let them.
So I can see Ruchi, Shweta, a couple of others trying to log in. So I'll take a minute more in case they're able to connect and then we get started. So hi, everyone. It's a good evening for you. Are we all set? I'd like to see your faces. If you can switch on the cameras, I'd be really happy to interact with you. Okay, I think the other two are not able to join. Okay, good. I'd like to start with a very interesting discussion with you. What is it that you'd like to do to stay healthy and happy throughout your life? You know, I had this very interesting conversation in one of the groups and somebody said, I'd like to be unmarried. Yeah, so sometimes it does happen that we see life differently and each one of us has, I think, their own definitions of being happy. What's important for you to know is that how do you see it for yourself? And that's exactly why I want you to think about this question as to what is it that you need to do to keep yourself healthy and happy throughout. So if I were to ask you, how would you invest in your future? Would your answer be by getting a good job in working, in aviations, getting good money for yourself? I'd not be surprised really, because that's pretty much how most of the millennials today, most of the even generation X and Y would respond. The results though, because of this wiring, are very, very different. So we all know how we are wired, to get a job, to get more money. We're all a part of a rat race today. very soon we realize that it's just not helping us. And I think COVID era is one thing that has made all of us realize where we are going and what, how it is impacting our lives. So it's a wake up call. We know the stress and anxiety level has gone up. We know the mental health has deteriorated drastically. India is hovering around 138, out of 144 on their happiness index. And something surely is not okay. So the next time around you think about what should I do to invest in my future, one thing you must count for sure is the investment in your own happiness, come what may. So I'd like to share my screen. Can I just quickly do that? And I'm hoping all of them have their pen and papers or colors with them. Can you all see the screen? Can you respond in the chat, please?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Can you all pull out your pen, paper, colors, whatever you have? Because we're going to do a little bit of drawing now. Yeah? So let's draw an elephant. And I need you to do it with all sincerity. And then show your drawings. I understand that you may not want to come on the screen because you may be in pajamas or inside your blankets or whichever way you're comfortable. I'm okay with that. Let's ensure that you show your drawings at least and talk a little about it. We'd love to see those drawings. So I'm going to be giving you another 3 minutes to draw your elephant. And then we're going to have a discussion. Say yes in the chat box, please. Let's see a couple of responses. I get to know you're awake and we're together on this. Okay, I see only one thumbs up from Rajeshri. How about the others? You could all do a thumbs up if you're doing it. So I get to know. How about Mansi, Shikha, Ruchi, Shweta, Surabhi, Divyanshi, I'm waiting for your responses. We're all at it. All of you are drawing your elephants. So we'll take a minute. Okay, who'd like to share their elephant with us? Let's see a couple of drawings, guys. Let's see your elephant on screen, please. You can hide your faces behind it. I'm okay with that. Let's see your drawings on the screen. Yes, ma'am, I did get all the responses. I'm waiting to see your elephants, guys. Okay, who'd like to share? This session will be interesting for you once you kind of become a part of it. And let's make this more interactive, more engaging for each one of us. And something that you can take back, a learning from. So I'm waiting for all of you to respond either on the chat box or show me your elephants so we get to know what kind of drawings we have done. Can I see responses in the chat box, please? Ranshi, Ruchi, Shweta, Shikha. Waiting for a response. Okay, so if you've drawn and you don't want to come on the camera, since nobody's responding, I'm guessing, let's hear your thoughts on what came to your mind when you started drawing that elephant. What were some of the thoughts that came to your mind? Were you like, oh my God, what is happening? Why do I have to draw? What was your response, initial reactions? Can I see some responses on the chat box, please? When was the last time that you did your drawings? I understand that you may be a little worked up. Okay, Rajeshri is responding. I did it in my school. Good to hear that. I will tell you the reason, Shweta. Don't worry about that. Let's do a little drawing first and then we'll talk about it. There is a purpose. You did it in college. Naina has responded. Good to hear that. Anyone else? Has anyone drawn the elephant? How can I draw it in this short span? Divyanshi says, we can give it a try. How to draw an elephant is my first thought, Mansi says. Okay, good. Thank you for sharing your thoughts. Unable to make it. All right. Shweta says, not sure how to do it. Let's hear a couple of other responses, please. Naina, Divyanshi, Shikha, what's your take on it? Have you drawn the elephant or what were your initial thoughts when I asked you to do it? I'm unable to make it. It's looking very funny. I'm not surprised with that. Trust me, I'm really bad at it too. It just reminds me of Tare Zameen Pe, when there was this setup where Amir tells everyone to do a little of drawing and only draw an elephant's face. Mansi said that. Okay, good. Mansi, I'm happy to hear this. Wonderful. Keep it up. So nonetheless, I want to draw out a very important aspect here. Most of the times in our life, I've drawn it completely. Thank you, ma'am, Mansi says. Good, Divyanshi. I'm so happy to see all the responses. All right, great going. So this particular, you know, just the elephant part, I've done this exercise several times in a lot of sessions, you know, in the past also. And most of the times people find it very awkward because they've not been drawing, and especially, you know, this kind of drawing they're not good at. So they won't really take that kind of ownership to show whatever they've drawn. But the good thing is, and the best part of about this exercise is, I've also found a lot of people who take a lot of pride in introducing their elephant. And irrespective of how it looks, there are times when they look like pigs and even a mouse for that matter. They definitely don't look like an elephant, but they take a lot of pride in showing it off. So this exercise is all about drawing out one of the most important elements of how you see and experience life. Can anybody tell or guess what I'm trying to hint at? What is the learning we're talking about here? Any thoughts on that? What do you think matters the most? If we talk about, you know, just learning from this very exercise. Do you have any reflections, any thoughts that's occurring to you right now? To improve memory, to be participative. Wow, Mansi, I love that. To improve memory, yes, okay. What else? Concentration, okay. Mansi's not sure, she's just smiling, all right. I'm okay with that. This time for me, completion over perfection, okay. So Divyanshi's response is also very nice. And I'd like to add to that. What really happens in life is, and everything that determines, you know, how you experience your life revolves around your own attitude. Yes, no? If you agree, say yes on the chat box. Do you agree with that? Do you think attitude has a huge role to play? Rajeshwari says yes, Mansi says yes, Divyanshi says yes, Naina says yes. Awesome. Very good. Good to see those responses, guys. And that's the fact of the matter, that today, if I were to just ask you, how are you feeling today? You know, are you having a good day? Are you happy? Are you sad? What would be your response to that? Let's hear a couple more responses. How's your day been so far? Good, bad? Are you having a good day? Yeah, anybody who wants to switch on their audio and talk at any point in time, just feel free, okay? We can talk. I'm going to ask you another question, and I hope that we're thinking about it while we talk. Why are you having a good day or a bad day is my next question. So if you're having a good day, why are you having a good day? If you're having a bad day, why are you having a bad day? Just think about these things, and whatever thoughts come to your mind, try to just keep them, take a note of it mentally. Or if you have paper and pen, even better. Okay. Anyone who'd like to talk? Anyone who'd like to reflect on it in whichever way? I'm going to ask you yet another question, and that's a very important question. And I already know the answer. That do you want to have a happy day or a good day tomorrow? Yes? Shweta wants a good day tomorrow. Who else wants a good day? Let's see a thumbs up. Yeah. Okay. So we all want to have a good day. I have no doubts about that. What's important for us to go back to is the second question as to why you're having a good day or why you're not having a good day. The answer to that is going to help you reflect on your relationship with happiness. So this discussion today is more about understanding happiness, your relationship with happiness. And most importantly, getting some tips and some hacks on how you can invest in your own happiness, which is securing yourself and equipping yourself with one of the most important future skills, proven through research. And this is a very important research that is, that was conducted by Robert Waldinger. This research was conducted in Harvard, and they started to study almost, small little boys, 700 plus young boys, up to the age of 75 years. And this is one of its kind of a research where they wanted to understand how can somebody stay happy or what takes care of their well-being, as human beings. Most of these kind of researches that span over so many years, it just fades off because people die. Sometimes the people who are involved in the study, they kind of leave, or some kind of other problems happen, or the person who's leading that report also leaves the company. Thankfully, this Harvard study, went through all the test of times, and it was well concluded. And you know what they found out? What was the proof of living a happy, healthy life? Any guesses on that? Anyone wants to share? Anyone wants to share what guesses you have? No? Let's hear some responses. Obviously, yes. Okay. What are your guesses? What do you think they found out in that research? What is it that helps anybody to stay healthy and, takes care of their well-being? So I can also share with you that out of these 724 men that they studied, there were around, 70, 80 of them that are still alive as on date. They're close to 90 plus, and they are, participating in the study still. Very good. Divyanshi says they're positive mind. Any other guesses? Anyone else wants to guess? What do you think the research concluded? What was one of their key findings? And it's really important because this study is relevant to all humankind. And you and I know already the impact of COVID and how it's impacting our lives. I know you guys are, stressed out because of a lot of sessions going on. There may be an overload of information right now. Trust me, this session is really going to help you lifelong. And it's not a momentary, discussion that we'd want to have. So I'd really appreciate if all of you start contributing your thoughts, and let's have a healthy discussion and, make this more interactive for us. What else do you think could be a possible, research conclusion there over these 75 years of their, study? Any other guesses? Anyone wants to add? Positive mindset, Divyanshi said. And let me share that the final conclusion was more around happy, relationships. So we're all social beings. And I still remember when the lockdown started, my first thought was, oh my God, how am I going to survive this? Because I am more a people's person. I've always been in interactions. So I really had my doubts how humanity will respond to it. And we can all see it's evident that one of the major things we're missing out, or we did miss out the most now that we have a little relaxation, we're meeting or we're interacting more also face to face. But otherwise, this was one of the most important aspects, that got impacted because we didn't have a social life. Coming back to the point that when we speak about social relationships, we're also talking about relationship with ourselves. And if we're not happy people, if we don't have that positive mindset, like Divyanshi rightly pointed out, a lot that happens in our life goes out of our hands. We can't do nothing about it. And that leads me to another very important thought, which is, what is it that really makes you happy? What are certain things that you do that make you happy? Can somebody share? What really makes you happy? I'm looking for your responses in the chat box. To fulfill my work, okay. Rajeshri says to fulfill my work, well said. What else? What else makes you happy? Let's hear a couple more responses. Come on, guys. I'm sure you know him and you experience this. Fatima, Naina, Ricky, what makes you happy? How would you experience it? What has happened in the past that has made you really happy? Anyone else? Yeah, it is fulfillment of work for sure, like Rajeshri said. But at the same time, you know, sometimes I feel that, okay, Mansi says being myself, Divyanshi says encouragement makes me happy. I agree, okay. Anyone else would like to respond? So nonetheless, yes, please.
Thanks, that makes me happy.
Yes, Ricky. What makes you happy, Ricky?
That doing creative things every day. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, you're audible. I can hear you.
Okay, I'm telling you, to do creative things that makes me happy.
Nice. Okay, doing creative things. All right. Yeah. Wonderful. So being myself is something that also kind of encompasses that, I guess. So when you're yourself, you can do things that mean something to you, that you're passionate about, like being creative. That's a wonderful answer. And trust me, sometimes we don't realize, and most of the times when I see youngsters or my siblings, other friends and colleagues, a lot of what makes us happy depends on how somebody else is doing something for me, or their reactions, or the environment. We seek validation, and therefore we end up, you know, getting our happiness gets canned. Okay, we limit ourselves.
Definitely.
Yeah. So our mind is more like this fleeting balloon; it just keeps floating around. And when I were to tell myself I really seek happiness in my life, if it's just wandering around with people and their, you know, responses or what they say and what they do with me, I'm never going to get that sense of accomplishment, right? So one of the top things that you need to remember is, if you really want to be happy, let's stop outsourcing this happiness. So I need you to take 2-3 minutes and think about a happy moment in life. You know, what really made you happy? Whatever accomplishment, whatever, you know, family moment, irrespective of where it's coming from, just think through it. And try to tell yourself whether it is internal to you or is it external to you. What really makes you happy is that happening from the outside world, it's dependent on the outside world, or is it more to do with you? Can you tell me, is it external or internal? In the chat box, please. External, okay. And do we hence find it very difficult? And if we constantly chase it? And does it disappoint us then? Yeah, say yes if you agree. Ricky says it's more internal for her. I can guess that, Ricky. Okay, Naina also says it's internal for her. Wonderful. Lovely to hear that. But the more external it is, you know, don't you think it's going to get even more evasive because it keeps running away from us and it's always dependent on the other people? Wonderful. Divyanshi says it, happiness always comes from inside. Superb answer. Yeah, I love that. So I'm going to ask you another question. Then what stops us from getting happy? You know, because it's all internal then. Most of us are, you know, already cognizant of it, that it's coming from inside. What is it that stops us from being happy then? What do you think happens? What goes wrong? Why don't we get that sense of happiness or accomplishment? Sorry, I'm just going to take a sip. What do you think goes wrong? Mm-hmm. Thank you for being so candid, Divyanshi. Yeah, they are complexes that we go through. Our mind starts to, you know, play games with us. What else? What else stops us? What else do you think hinders or blocks us from becoming happy? So one thing is for sure, the attitude is what counts the most, which we spoke of in the initial exercise itself. We'll delve deeper into this. Naina says it's commitments, which sometimes get in the way of happiness. I kind of hear you, Naina. We'll delve more into it as we move forward. Competition always comes, yeah, always takes the real charm of life, I guess. Good, well said, Ricky. It does affect us in several ways. And for some strange reason, we see competition also in a very different way. You know, it's always that school, first kon aayega, second kon aayega, or third kon aayega. You know, in life,
yeah,
you really...
To some degree.
Yes.
Yeah, definitely. According to me, competition to some degree, it's good. But if it is a beyond degree, then it's horrible for your life. Sometimes it makes your life atrocious and you are always after something. You're not happy, you're not satisfied. Yeah. So I think competition to some degree is good, but if it is not to some degree, then it's horrible in your life.
Very well said. In fact, it's also to do with our own perception, you know, how we're taking it. So
yeah,
so competition is self-imposed to a great extent. It's also because of the education system, Ricky.
Definitely.
We're
definitely.
Not to be blamed. You know, this is how the rate system grading works in the schools and colleges. Then you have sports, you know, competitions.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And everywhere, you know, that same psychology is getting built in. Pehla kon aaya, first kon aaya, second kon aaya. So, you know, it's not in our hands. And we've started to do the same thing in our own life.
Yeah, I have been listening to this thing since my childhood, but I'm very happy that I'm blessed with a great father who always asked this question that how much percentage you got this time? I said, Papa, this much. Okay, what was the last percentage you got? Think, Papa, this much. Okay, that's good. So he always compared my results with the last one. So I'm happy with this thing, but I think this thought must be implemented by everyone.
Awesome, Ricky. I'm so glad you shared that. And that is so very true. You know, I was also blessed with a father who never compared us with anyone else. And he would always tell us to better ourselves day in and day out. And that's the only sense of competition that I've ended up developing.
Definitely.
You know? And Rajeshwari is saying that she too believes in this kind of, you know, aspect that we must compete with only ourselves. In that case, our happiness will always be in my hand, not like the fleeting balloon, you know, which gets wavered and floats around according to people's reaction or their, you know, expectations from me. So that's a very important learning for us to go back with. Also, I need you to understand how happiness, you know, how is this feeling of happiness? Because we sometimes, you know, confuse it with something else. Before that, I want you to watch this video. Just give me a second. I'll just pull it up for you. Can you hear it? Can we all see it?
No, it's not visible and audible.
Just give me a second then. You can see the PPT only, is it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Is it okay now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
ma'am. Okay.
No, the video is not visible.
Sorry?
The video is not visible.
That's what I checked. One second. Everyone can't see it?
Yeah, I can't see it.
You can't see it. One second. It should have been visible. One second. Let me know if you can see this window. You can, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Let me know if you can see the audio and the video.
Yeah, I can see the folder.
You can still see only the folder?
Yes, ma'am.
I don't know what's the problem. We just tested that. It was working. One second. Visible?
No, ma'am.
Video still not visible?
Yes, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Can you hear the song?
No.
No, ma'am.
So we're going to enjoy the song for the time being, okay? ये मत कहो खुदा से मेरी मुश मेरी मुश्किलें ये मत कहो खुदा से मेरी मुश्किलें इन मुश्किलों से कह दो मेरा खुदा ये मत कहो खुदा से कह दो I hope you could hear the song. Yes?
Yeah, little bit, not well.
Not completely?
Yeah, not completely. Somewhere.
Oh, okay, one.
But I really want to appreciate your singing.
Thank you so much, but this is... not done. We tested and it was fine. So anyways, we're going to try again. I think as long as you can hear this, this is really powerful. Let's just concentrate on hearing it like a podcast. You can hear it, right? Okay.
I can't. I don't know if I'm the only one who is facing this issue, but I think, yes, there is some issue from my side. Yeah, I can't listen audio and I can't see video as well.
Audio is more important. So anyway, we're going to close all the other windows so that there's no distraction whatsoever. You can see my screen.
Yeah, I can.
The screen is visible.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The video actually communicated a definition of happiness. And I'll resend it maybe before playing it next time around because we just tested everything was working fine. So nonetheless, it's more about the definition of happiness and how we see it. In a nutshell, happiness is more to do with celebrating what you already have. You know, mostly we tend to chase, you know, different things. And the minute you get something in your life, what you experience is not happiness. What is that called? what we experience when we get something in our life, say a mobile phone or a car or a house, or we get happily married. Those moments and those events in our life bring us real happiness, or do you think it's something else? What do you think that is?
It brings real happiness to our life, definitely.
Mm-hmm. When you get a phone, you think what we experience is happiness?
Yeah, if there is need and the need is fulfilled by something, then you say that you're happy.
Hmm. We say we are happy, but do you think that really is happiness?
Marriage is real happiness sometimes. It's a new phase. It's a great phase of your life. So, yes.
Yeah. So, except for marriage.
Happiness, but I'm not. From my personal perception, so I really want to say one thing, that my happiness is not linked with the materialistic thing.
Okay.
My happiness is not connected with materialistic things, but yes, people makes me happy a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So with people, with my loved ones, I always feel elated.
Awesome. I'm glad you said that. And can I get your name, please? I'm not able to see your name.
Ricky Mishra.
Ricky, okay. Thank you, Ricky, for sharing this. How does it actually feel when you're happy? So now that we mentioned these moments happen and we genuinely feel happy, especially with friends, we genuinely feel happy. How is this feeling of happiness? You know, maybe our loved one's marriage, maybe our own marriage. What is this feeling like, you know, when you're really happy? What happens? Can you explain that feeling, anyone? Ricky, do you want to try?
But I think this are the happiness that are inestimable in nature, that you can't express in words.
Mm-hmm.
But as you are telling me and you are saying to try it, so definitely I'm going to try on it.
Mm-hmm. Let's think.
To me, what I feel when I get happy. Mm-hmm. My mother makes me feel happy. My husband makes me feel happy. My father makes me feel happy. And mm-hmm. these are the happiness that you can't measure on the scales.
True.
So definitely, these are the things that you can't express in words as well. But when I am happy, I am on the sky. I'm on the cloud nine.
I'm so happy, Ricky, you tried this. So I'm going to ask everyone to imagine, you know, you're really hungry and you're starving for the last, you know, say 10 days, and you suddenly get something nice to eat, say puri aloo and something that's one of your, you know, favorite meals. And the person starts to serve one serving after the other. What happens in the first, attempt when you have that food? We relish it, right? We enjoy it because we're starving. But the third mm-hmm. meal or the fourth meal onwards, if the mm-hmm. person continues to, you know, give that serving for, say, 10 more times, do you mm-hmm. think we're going to enjoy it? Do you think we're going
to? No, the satisfaction level will decrease.
Yes. So there are times, you know, in your life when we have these multiple experiences, okay? So you're getting maybe a mobile phone, you're getting something that you really wanted for quite some time, you had a target to get your own house, and you've accomplished it, you know? Mm-hmm. It creates a momentary joy for us. That's mm-hmm. not happiness. What we experience in those transient moments is pleasure, it's joy, it's not happiness.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because it's still dependent on someone else. And mm-hmm. in a very strange way, you know, pleasure is something that uses itself every time you experience it.
Mm.
So like I gave you the example of having that meal. Similarly, it would go for something else also. So I give you one mobile after the other. After collecting 10 of those bottles, you know, the 11th one will have absolutely no relevance to you. It ceases to give you pleasure. And that's how you can identify whether that feeling is happiness or not. Okay, something that ceases to exist or eats on to itself with every experience is only pleasure or joy. For example, if I were to ask you, you mentioned you're married. So every time you have these nice, moments to yourself, when you sit and chat or just sipping coffee, looking outside the window, enjoying good weather together, You may do it several times and you'll never be bored out of it. Yes, no?
Yeah, definitely.
Isn't that true? So when, you know, when it's happiness, the way to identify what it feels like is that you're in that moment and you enjoy every bit of it. You have no time to compare. You have no time to criticize. You have no time to think about anything else in your life when you're happy. Yeah? And you're also exuding this happiness. And that's another difference between these two, you know. So Dr. Robert Lusting is one of the researchers and psychologists. And he very clearly mentioned, you know, when you're in pleasure, pleasure is... Sorry. Go ahead.
Your voice is breaking. I was not able to listen you.
Am I audible now?
Yeah, now you are audible to me.
Okay. So is it just Ricky and I who are discussing, or I hope the others are talking? Naina, Rajeshwari, I hope everybody is talking to me. Yeah. So let's hear other responses also.
Yeah, definitely.
What is it? What is this feeling of happiness? And what's your take on pleasure, joy, happiness? Do you agree that joy and pleasure is more fleeting? It kind of goes away with time, with every experience, whereas happiness stays with you. You know, it's forever. It's a more steadier feeling. It's a steady, high life condition that you start feeling, you know. What's your take? How would you differentiate? Do you think they're different? Say yes in the chat box if you agree. Joy and pleasure is fleeting. It kind of is momentary, whereas happiness is more steady and it stays with you. Okay, Rajeshwari says yes, definitely. Okay. And would anyone else, Naina also says yes. Good to hear those responses. Would anyone else want to try? How does it feel to be happy? So do you think happiness lies in the past or in the future or in the present? Where does it lie, according to you? Just write your responses in the chat box.
According to me, happiness lies in the present, as because we enjoy every moment of life, and the happiness is today only, like where we are living, what we are doing.
So let me know your name, sweetheart.
Divyanshi Rastogi.
Divyanshi, thank you so much for that wonderful response. It is the present that makes you happy, right? Everything else would only drain you out of your energy. So planning for future is good. It's required. It's constructive. But when we get so absorbed in future, we call it in psychological terms, we call it catastrophizing your life. You are actually not in the moment at all. When we start thinking about the past too much, we ruminate, which means we sulk, we blame ourselves, we criticize, we live in guilt. A lot of angst, a lot of fear also starts to build up because of our past mistakes. So these two energies, you know, actually eat on to your present and don't allow you to enjoy what is happening right then. So another element of happiness is also being mindful, being in the present, like Divyanshi rightly pointed out. It is about being non-comparative. It's about being who you are. It's about accepting things that are happening in your life and just enjoying it, you know, like a little kid does, like children do all the time. Don't you think so? We always see little children all so gleeful and happy and cheerful, and we're like, hame kya karna padega to be like them. You know, the fact of the matter is we've lost that charm ourselves by thinking too much, by planning too much, by complicating our lives. We love complicating. Yeah, we don't like simple things in life. We find ways to complicate it. So I think this is another very, very important aspect, that if you keep it dear in your life, how to simplify life, how to take moment by moment, you know, rejoicement and enjoy. And somebody gave me this lovely definition of life, you know, that actually my dad says that life is all about creating good memories.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, that's all that there is to life. Right. So I think the corona time made us all think through it. And we all know the meaning of life more now than we knew before, you know, COVID era. Don't you agree? Yes, Naina says yes. Yeah. So we all know the value of our relationships. We all understand the value of health now. We also need to know the importance of investing in happiness too. I think that's doubly, doubly important because the stress and anxiety is not going anywhere else. What is required is for us to be more capable. So there's this anecdote of a tree, which is always used in most of our sessions, where we talk about the tree facing all the winds, you know, strongly. And the one that never gets uprooted is the one that has deep roots. Mm-hmm. So investing in yourself is actually investing in your well-being and happiness. And if you're able to do that, you have a very, very strong base for yourself throughout your life, irrespective of what challenges, what adversity, what setbacks, what rejections you face. You will always be able to surmount it with that strength from inside.
Okay.
Yeah. So let's hear a short story. I'm sure you all love stories, don't you? Do we all love stories? Yeah?
Definitely.
So let's hear this short story. It's about a monk with his two disciples. And he tells one of his disciples, both of them actually, to go up a certain mountain and fetch a herb for him. Okay. On the way, he specifically mentioned them to, wait by a pond and get the clear crystal water from there, go to a particular forest and fetch a particular flower from there, and then go to that mountain and be back on time before it's dark. So his instructions were pretty clear and also very specific. Both the disciples went off. One of them decided to, wait by the pond and enjoy that clear water and sipped the water too while he carried some. He also went into the forest and, enjoyed the shade, sat under the tree for some time, and then, went up on the mountain, realized that it was sunset time, sat there, enjoyed the sun and the sunset moment, and then went back towards the monastery and was back well in time. The other one did exactly what was instructed to him and ensured that he fetched the water, went to the forest, picked that particular flower, went up to the mountain, and he was back before time. So both the disciples did their tasks. What do you think was a major difference between the two? And who do you think was better off when it comes to life? Which one? The first one, the second one? Who do you think had better experiences? First one, second one, I'm waiting. Which disciple had the better take on it? Who had better experiences? You can put your speakers on and talk or respond in the chat box. The voice was breaking, so didn't get the story. Oh, couldn't hear me, is it?
Yeah.
You want me to repeat it?
Definitely.
Okay, no problems. Yeah. No problems. I'll repeat myself quickly.
Mm-hmm.
So it's about this monk and his two disciples. Am I audible now?
Yeah, now you're audible.
Okay, so it's about mm-hmm. the monk and his two disciples. Mm-hmm. He told both the disciples to take a certain terrain, fetch clear water from a certain pond, then go to the forest, pick the flower, a particular flower, and go up to the mountain hill and fetch a certain herb for him and come back before it's dark. Okay, so his instruction was clear, specific to both the disciples. The first one decided to stay by the pond, enjoy the clear water, and fetch that water for his master, went into the forest, enjoyed the, shade, sat under a tree, enjoyed a fruit also, and then went up to the mountain where he decided to enjoy the sunset too. After some time, he decided to, head back. Mm-hmm. Obviously, he picked the herb also and reached back before time. Mm-hmm. Or well within time, I would say. The other one did exactly what the monk told him to do. Mm-hmm. And he went to the pond, fetched the clear water, went to the forest, got the flower, and then went up the mountain and got the herb and was back before time. So while both the disciples did what was required and they completed the task, who do you think had a better experience?
First one.
The first one. Undisputable, right? Mm-hmm. And this is where we need to reflect how you're looking at life. What's your perception? Mm-hmm. There are so many times, you know, when you travel through the mountains and there's this one person who's constantly dizzy and puking away and doesn't know what to do because the mountains don't suit me. And the other person is, you know, constantly caught up in that scenic beauty and is so absorbed, you know, and tells himself that, you know, this is like heaven to me. Both of these people are on the same terrain in that same car. Yeah. But the experiences are absolutely diverse.
Yeah.
What determines that experience is their own perception, is their own lens.
Definitely.
Yeah. It's their orientation, how I see things. And trust me, most of the things we do in our life is dependent on this attitude and perception only. Right? So going back to our elephant exercise, if I were to just draw anything and say, hey, you know what? I know how to draw an elephant. Wait. And I draw something like this. I don't even know how to draw an elephant, but I'll try. Huh? I don't know how to draw it. I still remember somebody drew a elephant which looked like a mouse. And somebody drew it as if it was a rat. And then I was quite amazed. I was like, how come you're so happy about it? He said, because I did my best. Because I drew whatever I could do. Yeah. I can draw the back view of the elephant. Okay. So irrespective, you know, what's my perception towards life? What's my attitude? Something goes wrong. What do I say to myself in my head? That's all that matters. And trust me, there are certain things that I do and they really help me. I start to animate the person in whichever way I can. I can draw a parallel animated character in my mind. And it just relaxes me, you know. It doesn't bother me. I don't take it personally then. And I'm able to move on quickly. These are tricks and, you know, patterns that you can develop over years of your practice. It doesn't come overnight. I've been doing it as a child because my dad taught me this. And it has always, always, always helped me. While in corporates also, I would do that and I would laugh and giggle. And sometimes the other person wouldn't understand why am I doing something like that. Obviously, I won't do it on their faces. But I could ease off from that stress, you know.
Okay.
Just a snap, and it worked like magic because stress never bothered me. And I've been an OD, so I've handled a lot of projects, lot of ambiguity, and lot of complexities too. And this has been one of the things that has always helped me. So that's a little, you know, experience sharing with you. Try if you want to. I also know that most of us get bogged down because of people's expectations from us, right? So sometimes I remember my brother saying, you know, my dad wants me to become a dentist. He always wanted to do something else, like become an entrepreneur or a businessman. He was not cut for dentistry at all. But in some strange way, he's landed up being one. So, you know, that's how much stress plays a role in our life. And sometimes we end up meeting other people's expectation, but never feeling happy inside. Yes, no, you agree?
Yeah.
Yeah, let's hear more responses in the chat box. Yeah, so what really, really makes me happy is my own self-belief. What really makes me happy is my effort. It's my, you know, tenacious commitment to something and that perseverance through which I achieve something. So somebody did mention your work gives you happiness. You know, why that work gives you happiness is because you're determined, you're committed, you're doing that day in and day out. But the day you start to get too absorbed with it and you start, you know, trying to be a perfectionist, most of our mothers do that. You know, they want to be perfect in every sphere of their life. And because of that, their source of happiness gets affected. Because A, they ignore themselves, okay? They forget about their hobbies or their talents. And three, they're trying to please everyone. Don't you think that becomes a source of unhappiness?
Yes.
We agree? And I've always felt for my mother, you know, and for elders around me or my, you know, maternal aunts or whoever, who would just not give importance to themselves. So as women, this is one of my projects, you know, after I've left the corporate career, that women must be happy because they are like the sun in the family. If you start to exude energy, you start to exude happiness, everyone around you will be happy too. But if the woman is unhappy, God forbid, everyone else in the family can never be happy. Okay? If that lady is not happy, that's the kind of energy that goes around in the house then. She's getting angry, she would shout, there's frustration, there's going to be discomfort for so many people around, right? So what's important is for you to take those breathers for yourself and give time to yourself and not get into the whirlwind of, you know, pleasing people or trying to be perfect at everything. So the new mantra for all of you is that 8 is the new 10. You know, I've had several rounds of discussion with my mother-in-law saying, aapke zamane mein aisa hota tha, humare zamane mein aisa hota hai. So yeah, if this is what is happening, it's good enough, right? Because our realities have changed. The environment has changed. The demographics have changed. Our, you know, fabric of the family has changed. We're more in nuclear families today. So because of those fundamentals, what women should expect from them should also come 2 notches below, right? So if you go back with this mantra, I'd be really happy that 8 is your new 10. Please don't try to be perfect on everything and try to get a 10 on 10. Yeah, 10 on 10 is a daughter, 10 on 10 is a wife, 10 on 10 is a daughter-in-law or son-in-law. I don't think there are the boys in this group, no, right? So that's what makes all the difference. You know, you have to start breaking out from these shells and tell yourself that you are supremely talented. Okay, our next discussion is going to be more around weaknesses or things that we're not very happy about. So I'm going to ask each one of you to share at least one weakness according to you. What is that one thing that you're not very happy about? It could be a bad habit, it could be a weakness, it could be something that you're attempting to improve on. What would be that one thing, that weakness of yours? Can you share in the chat box? I'm lazy, okay? Rajeshwari is so prompt in saying lazy that I have my doubts. You were not lazy in sending your response, Rajeshwari. I really like that. What else? Let's see more responses, guys. Naina? Where are the other girls? Okay. Surabhi says a little negative. Okay. Divyanshi. How about others? Mansi. Let's hear, what is that one thing that you're not very proud of? Something that's bothering you or something that you're trying to work on? You're also a bit lazy, Divyanshi says. Okay. Good. I'm happy you guys are so candid about sharing it. Wow. So wouldn't, you know, sometimes these are things that really embarrass us and we get so bogged down. We don't want others to know it. We try to, you know, hide these things from other people. Kisi ko pata nahi lagna chahiye. But would it help you if I were to tell you, these are some very common weaknesses or challenges or shortcomings. And it's common across the world. Okay. Getting angry, being temperamental, being very anxious or stressed out, emotionally very, very sensitive, not very sure in life, getting confused very often, or being negative, like Surabhi said. Laziness is also there, Rajeshwari, you'll be happy to know. Even planning, organizing is there in the list, you know, not able to manage time well. And these vulnerabilities, just because they're common, how does that make you feel? Ricky says she's not a morning person. That's not a big weakness. It's okay. We can live with it. But going back, you know, what is it? How does it make you feel if I'm sharing this with you that almost 45 countries have been surveyed around something like this? And these are very common findings. You know, all of them, all of us have these weaknesses. How does that make you feel? Does it make you feel better? Yes? Just say yes in the chat box. So many people across the world are lazy. So many people across the world are confused, anxious, not sure. They also get very, very angry. There are so many people who are equally emotional. Does that make you feel better? Yes, Meghna says yes. Yes, good. And do you think it's going to help us, you know, bond better or connect better with people once we know that these are common weaknesses? Because we tend to shell ourselves so that people don't get to know. But when we know it's common, it really helps us to connect with other people. And there's a very, very high amount of trust that we tend to develop because of that very factor. So, okay, Devanshi says, my laziness doesn't make me feel embarrassed. I'm so happy to hear this. But sometimes, you know, we don't want everyone else to know about it for sure. While we may not be embarrassed if somebody gets to know, but we don't readily share this, right? We are very happy to share. I'm a confident person. I like talking to people. Whatever my strength is, I would prefer to talk about it. But I may not prefer to talk about my laziness. Yes, Devanshi, what do you think? We don't prefer to talk about these things, do we?
Yes, because it is a sort of comfort for me, but that is only for me, not for others. So I don't
exactly what I wanted to say, that, you know, once we start to accept these vulnerabilities, we actually become really free in our own mind, because we are constantly trying to check ourselves or correct ourselves or hide these things from the other people or not talk about it, so to say. But the day we become comfortable, the day we accept it as who we are in entirety, we really become free. And that freedom gives us immense happiness. You know, most of the people who connect with the psychologists today are individuals who are not able to connect with their true self. Okay? We want ourselves to be perfect on every front. But the day we realize that all of us are equally imperfect and we accept, you know, this entirely, we become free and happier, right? So what's important is also to go back with the thought that you are extremely unique individual, but at the same time, you are also limitless, right? So if we can all become doctors of happiness and you know, have this unlimited power in us, we can achieve whatever we set our mind to. And that's why I think a lot of people talk about law of attraction. How many of you believe in it? How many of you actually believe in law of attraction? I think a lot of our achievers like Will Smith, Jim Carrey, a lot of other, even sportsmen have been talking about it, how they've visualized something in their life and they've actually made it happen. Jim Carrey, for that matter, has actually done that. You know, he wrote a check of 10 million when he was nothing. And just another 7 years or 5 years, he actually made that amount, exact same amount. So it's not just theory, it's not philosophy, like a lot of us tend to think it's good to read and good to hear only information. It is something that has happened in somebody's life. That's why the person is talking about it. So how many of you believe in the law of attraction? I think you must use it as a tool for yourself. Visualize your next 5 years and see how you can tap into that highest possibility for yourself. I've seen people create wonders in their life. How many of you believe in it? Let's hear. Let's get some responses in the chat box. We're going to take another 5-7 minutes before we wind off.
Yes, ma'am. I read one quote, which is act as if what you do makes a difference, it does. So that I really like.
Awesome. Good that you mentioned this. And anyone else who'd like to share? Ricky is saying, yes, I believe in it. Good. What are some of the tips and hacks that you would follow? You know, one thing I can share for sure is that we need to start being more thankful in life. You know, count your blessings. So gratitude is one universal mantra given by experts today. That if we start appreciating life, you know, you see your life opening up in a very different way. So that's one of the things that you can do for sure. When we start training our mind to be happy, you're able to sustain it better. You know, I even like what Bhumani Irani did in Munna Bhai. You know, when he was managing his anger, he would laugh. And that's one of the anger management techniques, you know. And you can always try that. When something upsets you, can you actually train your brain to not respond the way it does? Instead of reacting, can you respond? Instead of apologizing or saying sorry, can you say, thank you so much for waiting for me? I really appreciate your patience. Can you change this, these words? Because the words we are using are the words that we are talking to ourselves also. You know, the more we say, I'm sorry, I apologize, the more we start feeding this negative to our minds. And that's how sorry we become for ourselves too, unfortunately. So let's try to replace I am sorry with I appreciate. That's one of the tips I'd want you to take back. The other is that start using more thank yous in life, sense of gratitude or appreciation as much as possible for every little thing, even that water that comes in your tap or the food or the meal that you're getting every day of your life. Start doing that. Okay, appreciating each and every aspect of it. Trust me, I started appreciating my maid a lot because after the lockdown, I realized the worth of having a maid at home. Okay, so it is important that we acknowledge and we also become more considerate of other people. That kindness also starts to grow in your life, you know, in the form of a happier, well-being, you know, individual for yourselves. If you are, you know, letting go of the negative, you need to also start checking your belief system. Because what happens is, if I ever failed as a captain, and I have started telling myself, I'm a failure, you know, as a captain, I can't lead people. Even in today's life, whatever responsibility is given to you, you will always have that limiting belief in your mind. Try to take out 5-10 minutes to just identify how many such limiting beliefs you have and do away with it or replace it with a positive one that I will try, or I have done this and I will be able to do this, you know, with very positive affirmations. There's one negative point as well, as I will always be so pre-planned before doing anything that makes me a bit conscious. Okay, Divyanshi says that she tends to over-prepare. I'm glad you said that over-preparation is not good. Preparation is good, but over-preparation is not good. It does affect your, you know, complete, I think, delivery or the effectiveness of your delivery. So you can try under-preparing and go with the flow, right? It's not a negative, Divyanshi. You can always, you know, be a little more creative with whatever work you're doing and try to listen to your heart and your instincts. Sometimes that gives you better results than being over-prepared. So preparation is definitely an absolute essential, but over-preparation may not be necessary. You can consciously do that. Don't worry about it. Okay, I need all of you to do a little exercise before we wind off for today. We've learned 2-3 tricks also. Anybody has any questions? Let's take up 1 or 2 questions before we wind off with one quick activity. This one I really want you to do and tell me in the chat box. If you can't open your videos, I'm really missing out seeing your bright faces because the last one is more like a dance. So we're going to do it together. But any questions before we venture into that? Any questions, any thoughts, any last comments you want to share? I'm waiting. So how was the day? How was this discussion for you? Any comments, anything you want to share? I'd be happy to hear. I hope it was helpful. I hope it has allowed you to reflect to some bit. So it was a wonderful session. Don't have any questions. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. It was really an impeccable session. I really enjoyed. And also, there are so many things to be noted down so that we can imply that in future as well. So that's really helpful for me.
Wow. I'm happy to hear this. happy to help. What's your takeaway? Anyone wants to share what you like the most? What did you love? Any takeaway? How are you going to invest in your happiness? What are you going to do? What's that one happy habit that you're going to build for yourself? You know, having good friends and having good time with your friends is one of the best happy habits you can build. You know, so every time I'm morose, I would catch hold of one friend at least. Ensure I talk my heart out to that person. Yeah. So you can try using any of these techniques. I've also endorsed something called a happy circle. So form communities which engage into things that are of your interest. So somebody mentioned creativity helps. You should be a part of some clubs, you know, where that creativity is an ongoing process, so that that kind of input keeps coming in your life and you feel more fulfilled internally. And always seek happiness from inside. Don't outsource it to other people. Don't be dependent on validations. That's very important. So I'm so happy to hear this. We're going to do this small activity before we wind off. And I would love to hear your comments and feedback later also. And this is one of my favorites, because whenever I want to cheer myself up or, you know, cheer up my daughter also, we do this small gig. Okay, a small dance kind of a thing. Can you all see me? Can all of you see me?
Yes.
Am I visible? Okay. So here's what you need to do, and you need to all stand up and do it while I can't see you. I'd want to hear that in the comments once we are done with it. And just repeat after me. It's the Ram Lakhan Anil Kapoor thing, okay? It's Dina Dinta. Dina Dinta. Dina Dinta. Dina Dinta. Do that, everybody. Can I hear you? If I can't see you, I want to hear you all. Let's all do it. Just to unwind from everything you've done today, just to relax yourself, break out from everything, every stress, okay, every anxiety, and just, you know, tell yourself you're doing well and you're going to continue doing well in your life. And do dina dinda, dina dinda, dina dinda, dina dinda. Let me hear some of the responses. Great. I'm guessing that you all are doing it. Did anyone try? Or was I the only one who tried it? Yes. Okay, good, Divyanshi. I tried. Wow, Mansi. Do a gig. Do some laughter, do some amount of learning, do some amount of reading, live life, king size, and always, always believe in yourself. And jab bhi mat ka dialogue nahi hai, main apni khud ki favorite hoon. You should all become like that. Yeah. Always keep telling yourself that you're your favorite, because our first responsibility is also to look after ourselves. And self-care is not selfish at all. It's your right. Thank you so much. I had a wonderful, wonderful time discussing and, you know, having this conversation with all of you. I hope you've all enjoyed it and you're all going back with some learnings today. Aina said, I did. Yes, somebody wants to say something?
Hello.
Somebody wants to say something? So should we say goodbye, everybody? Ciao, everyone.
Raja Rajeshwari, you can conclude the session.
Okay, sir. We would like to propose a hearty vote of thanks to you, Shikha Verma, for gracing today's webinar and delivering the important topic on invest in your